Hey, so welcome everyone. I'm Barnabas, and Barnabas Depresny. I'm co-founder and CEO of Shinra, and what we do is we build payment gateway between public blockchains such as Ethereum and Bitcoin and the old and rusty legacy banking system. And we're building products around that. And yeah, I've been following Bitcoin and other projects since 2011. And yeah, that's about it.
Hi there. I'm Peter Norsiby, and I'm in the field of information security for the last 18 years. And since I'm a security guy, I'm a bit paranoid, so maybe I will have some silly questions to you guys here. That's it. Okay, first one. I'm also a member of the board of the ISACA Budapest chapter. ISACA is an international organization, information systems, audit and control association in more than 180 countries. And since this organization is about controlling and auditing IT and application and all this stuff. My basic concern is the controlling the applications, controlling the those modules that you just described here. So how you try to prevent malicious codes to build or vulnerabilities spreading around the P2P network?
Okay, good question. In all this architecture full of components and different layers, we identify several layers that are more infrastructure level, and we define the components there with another name, like add-ons are the ones there, and plugins are on the top. And the difference between add-ons and plugin is that add-on, they are built for by more trusted people, okay? More trusted people in the community, and they don't have to identify themselves to other components. While plugins, they use they have their own private keys to identify themselves with the others, and they can only consume certain service from the other. Let's give you an example. For example, there is an add-on that encapsulates the file system. Okay? In order to be the system to be portable to other operating system, the file system is encapsulated in one of these add-ons. So when a plugin is using the file system, it uses the add-on is requesting its identity. Okay, so it somehow segmented the file system and only use one piece of file system and encrypt it with the plugin private key or something like that. But there are mechanisms that might be implemented by code, okay? And others that need to be spot further, you know, this very young system.
Yeah, I think it's challenging since you need to make the code secure. I mean, I'm not talking about authentication, I'm not talking about authorization or encryption. I'm mainly talking about the error, sorry about that, the developer makes by definition. And application security is really, really the key part here, I think. So I know it's challenging, I don't know the answer yet. It's just my concerns on having a system which has less control than today. That's my understanding, sorry about that.
Yes, I believe that key is having a community with very talented people, and also that the system don't grow or don't expand too fast in order to give it time to mature and to find all the problems that naturally are going to be there. So both things are key to security.
Yeah, about growing, one thing is keeping it from growing fast, but the other thing is that there's so many cool stuff out there, and you have to grow fast to have to reach people, and if you want a system that is ubiquitous, then you need a network effect. So how will Fermat achieve the network effect that is much needed for these things to work? So if we take, for example, Bitcoin, it has that effect, but if we see it as on a global level, 7 billion people, there's probably a few hundred thousand active Bitcoin users, and no one knows about it. That's practically how it is, and it is already huge in the crypto press space. So what is the plan to achieve, you know, network effect and having 1 billion people using it?
I believe that it goes on the line of this, what we call the Internet of People. That is, this profile exposed to the peer-to-peer network and created different layers of network on themselves. But think about it, it's a public infrastructure that doesn't exist today, okay? Today you have big data monopolies like Facebook or any social network or even companies like Uber or whatever. Imagine a world where you can have, in contrast to a public blockchain or Bitcoin or Ethereum or whatever, you can have access to all these layers of people that are already on this public peer-to-peer network. Today you cannot do business with the people that Facebook have. You have to pay Facebook even to send an advertisement. Okay? Imagine that if you want to create a new mobile application, you already have a million taxi drivers there, or 2 million people doing online dating. And with your application, you don't start from zero. You don't start from zero from the coding point of view, but also you don't start from zero anymore from the user point of view. So all this scheme that you succeed by getting users, okay, is somehow disrupted or changed the point of view, in the sense that now the success probably is not going to be measured anymore in how many users you get, because the users are going to be there, and it's a public infrastructure like Bitcoin. It's just there, okay? And if your application, you are adding 500,000 users, then probably he comes and add another 500,000 users. So
So that means, for example, if Mark Zuckerberg decides to, get on board, then you think he will have motivation to share his 1.5 or whatever amount of users, or what's
well, the key is that the architecture of the system separates the identities from the application themselves. If you then enter into the system itself, you will see that you create your identity outside this application. So that means that if you create a chat profile, then what you have is an identity application to create that type of profile. Then you have a community application of chat users. That is a window to the network, of the layer of the network of all chat users worldwide or around you. Okay? But separated from that is the chat application. That means that I can do a chat application, you can do another, or you can do another, okay? But the users themselves are of the network, not yours or mine, you know? You can use the network. It's a totally shift from the way things are done today. It probably worked, probably not, I don't know. That's the idea.
I could rephrase it as, how will I start using it, or how will I know about it, or how will my mom know about it? So,
well, it will know it not because of me promoting it, it's the platform, but because of entrepreneurs that might be here or somewhere else that builds stuff on this platform and run a business out of this. You know, what I describe as this component embedded business model. It's a business model proposition for the developers of the application. But on top of that, you can run whatever business you want. Like the example I gave you was the network of taxi drivers that are background check. In the case of accommodation or Airbnb type of application, you can have a network of hosts that you provide insurance, for example. So you can build business on this, and you will promote whatever application you're building because it's a business, you're an entrepreneur. So these are the people who's going to take it to your
on what I just raised. I pretty much understand the motivation of the developer. Yeah?
Yeah.
What about the big companies, maybe governance who are games? How would you beat Facebook? How would you beat Google, eBay, and all these companies? And how would you prevent to be the next one?
I believe that the key on that is the efficiency that produces this public infrastructure on one side, and the possibility of disintermediation, because you don't need to go through the web or through this company. So this disintermediation property of this space is what gives end users lower transaction cost in a consistent basis, use case by use case. So you at the beginning will see people leaking from the web business model to this business model because it's cheaper, and probably if you refuse to do it, some point in time you will end up doing it because everybody is moving, you know? So what I expect is most business model running on the web to be ported to this space just because of the disintermediation and lower transaction cost and the transaction level. Make sense?
Yeah. apart from that, I would be really interested in what you guys think, what will happen in 20 years. So how will economies look like, how will business look like, how will the financial identity world look like?
Well, I talked a little bit about that, and I believe we are in the trend of digitalization of money, and there will be some system, I can imagine a system that is going to allow end users to run, to have their money in their own devices. I mean, Fermat itself is about choices and it's about freedom for the end user. So on our side, what we are going to what we are building with this platform is the possibility to end users in this future to choose between bankarized money or money in banks, or that means national currencies or supranational currencies as well. So we put the choice on end users. Between the people that chooses some part of the money to be in supranational currency, then you also have to choose between having the money yourself or put it on third party companies. Okay, I jump because of time some part of the explanation that explain how we expect to handle the use case when people choose to put some of their money in their own devices, okay? And the explanation to make it quickly is that on top of this peer-to-peer network, end users, you or me or whoever, can create what we call a private network, okay? That means you synchronize your phone with your laptop and 10 other devices, so your money is secured by these devices with multi-signature technology that is, you can keep value in a multi-sig vault. And you spend money from a petty cash wallet. So this is topped up automatically by this network of devices that nobody knows which they are, only you, okay? Because I run on top of this peer-to-peer network. So the future is, in our way, is going to look, what we try to build in the end is a future where people has the power in the end, no? Not companies or government, but people deciding. That's the end.
Coming from a security point of view, in 20 years from now, we will be unable to protect our information, our personal data, and in the world of cyber security, cyber crime, and all these things, you don't know what's the next ransomware virus or even human error will be that will that the end is that your information is compromised.
That's very terrible.
So we do. We do.
Yeah.
Yeah, just look around, I mean.
We already, our information is compromising everywhere.
You don't even know where they are. I mean, which data center, which, who does it?
Have you Googled yourself, for example? No, it's not what you see.
So does this mean we'll get completely naked and kind of, you know, virtually naked and we'll have no other choice than either distract ourselves or do the right thing and, not mess it up. So you will not have a choice. It could be very hard to be a criminal or, and that's... And I'm not saying that only criminals need privacy because, of course we need privacy. So I always ask people, when they say, you should only be afraid of cameras if you're a criminal, and you should only be afraid from the NSA if you're a criminal. And they always ask back, why do you go shitting on the toilet with the doors closed, right? So why not open it? So if you don't need privacy, then out on the streets.
But surely it's not just that all our crimes would be exposed, or all our embarrassing things would be exposed. It's also that you can fake embarrassing things. So we will have fake records. So if all
this is okay.
Hello.
Hey.
Hello.
It's on.
If we have records scattered across the web of things that we've done, of things that we've said, those can also be faked. So it's not even a case that we need to be worried about what we said. It's the case that we need to be worried about what someone else can make it look as if what we said. No?
Yeah, exactly. And what if there's so much embarrassing stuff out there that it's no longer embarrassing, right? Like no one cares because, right?
That's also true.
Yeah, you can now manipulate a video so everyone is having sex with an animal. you can do almost anything with video now. I have seen demonstrations of real-time face adjustment so that you can have you can have Donald Trump saying anything you want. I mean, he says anything anyway. But you can now fake video for anything. So it's even worse, I imagine. But let me give this to
you. My advice is choose an enemy wisely.
Yeah, Donald Trump, I think, is a great example of there's no limit to... doing embarrassing stuff that you do it and they still love you, so
yeah.
Right?
It's a
trick.
Okay. One more question, I guess.
Thank you. So, two quick questions about Fermat. I wanted in the presentation, but first is not so interesting that it's your app is running on Android, and if I'm a developer, then 80% of phones, let's say, are Android, 24% are iPhone, and developers make is money is 80% money is made on iPhones and 20% on Androids. And if I understood from your presentation, this app would probably not be allowed by Apple to run on Apple devices. So that was the less interesting thing. The most, maybe more interesting, is that I said it in last time here, you haven't been here, that one of my favorite quote is from William Gibson, that the present, the future is here, but it's not yet widely distributed. And some say, and I agree, that we are in a also post mobile device, post mobile phone world, and also mobile phones, the post up world. which was shown also in Google I/O and Apple Worldwide Developers Conference, and also in Cyanogen OS, which is on the release, that we are, that mobile OSs are going the post application. Thank you.
Okay, the system itself is written in Java, so it's expected to be ported to other operating system. We started with iOS, with Android, just because it has the largest market share right now. It has most of the layers, if you see all the architecture, most of the layers are Java component. Only the ones in the lowest layer is Java Android, that interface in the operating system and encapsulates different components there. And it needs to be replaced and ported to other operating system. And the user interface also has an Android framework, just to be able to create native Android application, and it's also replaced and supported to other operating systems. But most of the stack is portable. So we are going to others, but we first have to start somewhere. And the second part, I didn't get if it was a question or a statement you made.
Third question.
But can you repeat it, please?
So I repeated that some say that we are in post-mobile phone, but yeah, you can port it to whatever watch or on your brain or whatever, where the next device will be. And yes, the post-application, so post-op on mobile phones and whatever other mobile devices we are going to use, like, after mobile phones.
Well, what I see is a big trend on mobile, depending on mobile, that started 10 years ago and is going to continue growing. And I am, with the system, we are not, I'm not seeing the device that is running specifically, but the spaces, what I call these spaces. We mean the web, one big space where business can run there. The mobile application, regular mobile application, another big space, and this mobile peer-to-peer application, another space that's probably created by this type of system. Ready? What's up?
Yes, I cannot stop to think about the monetization of this platform. I understand it's open source, I'm fucking pretty pro open source solutions and open free software. Free as open. There is a way when the transactions over the architecture generates something for the components developer, for Fermat itself. I mean, if you talk about a street, for example, the government has to pavement the street, but they earn taxes for that and distribute all the money for spending good services. I'm wrong, or there is a monetization to cover the cost of the maintaining, calling, integration, reviewing, auditing code, the infrastructure itself, servers, the connection, the bandwidth.
Yes. Unfortunately, I cannot show you the architecture on the screen because it didn't work here. But these lower level components that I was explaining to him, that we call add-ons, they also get this micropayment, but they go to the foundation, the Fermat Foundation, that is the one responsible for maintaining on one side this master plan and continue to move it forward in the future, and also for the maintenance of the very basic and low level infrastructure of the system. On top of that is where the applications are run, okay? And components at the application level are owned by the developer who builds those components, and the same business model works for them also. Okay? More or less like that.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So we are ready with pizza?
Ready for pizza.
Okay. We have some pizza and...